Hello, I'm Bobby Galuba with OobaTech.com, and welcome to my sixth video. Today is Saturday, September 5th, 2015, but most of the video I recorded on Sunday, April 26th, 2015, and Sunday, May 3rd, 2015. In this video, I'm going to show you how I changed the belts on my 2003 Chevy Avalanche. So let's get to work and get the video rolling. Okay, I'm underneath my truck now, and I want to show you why I think I should change the drive belts on my engine. Now, one point is that I bought this truck, I believe, sometime before 2008, and it's 2015 right now, and I know I've never changed the belt, so they're at least 7 years old, so they're pretty old to begin with. And then if you look closely at the belts, you can see that they're kind of glazed on the outside, kind of shiny there. And you can see that the braids of rope that reinforce the belts are kind of starting to show through there. Those little lines right there are where the reinforcing fibers are for the belts. And you can see that on each one. So this inside one, which is closest to the engine that I'm touching now, that drives the air conditioning compressor. And then this one that's on the outside, which is farthest from the engine, drives everything else. Now, let's take a look at the number on here of this belt that drives the AC compressor. And it's upside down, but it says 4PK960. So let's take a look at the belt that I bought a few years ago, I think a few years ago, from Napa, and this one says 4PK962. So I think I'm going to probably have to go get a different belt that is for 4PK960. I don't think these two belts are compatible, and I don't want to go through all the trouble of taking it off and then putting this one on and finding out that it doesn't fit right. So I definitely want to make sure I get the right belt. Now, we'll go up top to take a look at the numbers on this larger belt here. Okay, so here's the large belt as seen from up top, and you can see the numbers on there. The GM number is GM12576450, and then there's another number that says, let's see, there's WBA, and then there's 6PK2345. And if you look at the replacement belt that I purchased, and this I purchased several years ago as well, and I meant to do this job a long time ago, but I've just been procrastinating. So this one also says 6PK2345. So I think that belt should work fine in that position. And this is a Goodyear Gatorback one, and it says the quiet belt. And I think this is probably the best kind to get. I used, I believe, the same belt on my F-150 that I have, and it seemed to work really well. The replacement belt that I originally put on my F-150 was a cheapo brand that I got from the auto parts store, some generic brand, and as soon as I put it on, it started squeaking. So I took it off, and I believe I put another Goodyear Gatorback on there, and man, that thing was quiet right away. So I think this belt will do well for my Chevy Avalanche, my 2003 Chevy Avalanche. Now, to get to the belt tensioner for the upper belt, which is down inside there, let's see if I can zoom in and see it. Yeah, so there's the bolt for it. It's a little hard to get it to focus in there. Let's see if we can get it to focus on there again. Yeah, I don't think it's wanting to cooperate, but it's down in there, and I think what I'm going to have to do is take off a portion of the air intake right here and possibly remove this hose here. I'm going to have to do a little more research about that, but I think that'll probably make it much easier for me to get to it because there's a lot of stuff in the way. And we'll take a look underneath as well to see what might need to be removed or changed underneath. Here's another view. And this belt, It drives the alternator here, the power steering pump down here, and I believe it also drives the water pump. So again, that's this belt here, the larger belt, which is farthest from the engine, that drives those accessories. Okay, I'm back. It's Sunday, May 3rd, 2015, and I went to Napa Auto Parts a few days ago to look to see if I needed to get an exact replacement for the belt that I currently have on my truck, which is a 4PK960. The replacement that I have now is a 4PK962, and I thought there might be a significant difference between the two, but apparently Napa's computer system cross-references the 4PK960 and suggests the 4PK962, and it indicates that they're pretty much equivalent. The only difference is a difference of 2 millimeters in length. The 962 actually indicates the length of the belt in millimeters, so this 962 indicates that this belt is 962 millimeters long, according to the guy at Napa, and that indicates that it's also actually this number here indicates that it's also 37.8 inches long. And I actually did the conversion on my computer, and sure enough, 962 millimeters is 37.874 inches long. And I'll show you a similar thing for the other belt that I have. This 6PK2345, oh, there's a little bug there. The 6PK2345 belt, the 2345 indicates that the belt is 2,345 millimeters long. And the 922 indicates that it's 92.2 inches long, which when I did the conversion is pretty close. If you convert 2,345 millimeters into inches, it's actually 92.3228 inches. Again, that's 92.3228 inches. So for those of you who are interested, that's what these numbers mean. Again, this number here is 2,345 millimeters, which is the length of the belt in millimeters, and this number here is 92, it represents 92.2 inches, which is the length of the belt in inches. Before I get started replacing the belts, I wanted to remind you about wearing your safety gear. The first is your safety glasses, like these stylish babies here. Look pretty good, huh? You always want to make sure you wear safety glasses, even if you think it may be something that may be safe, because it may be something that you'll end up getting something in your eye. One time when I was cleaning battery corrosion off of the terminals of the battery in my truck, a little piece of corrosion flew off and went right into my eye because I didn't have any safety glasses on. Luckily, I was able to get it out of my eye easily and it didn't injure my eye, but it could have been much worse than that. So again, you always want to make sure you wear your safety glasses to protect your eyes, and also to save yourself some money too, because it can be a big medical expense if you have to get your eyes examined and get them worked on. So the next thing, again, are your gloves. You want to make sure you wear gloves so that they'll protect your hands from cuts, and if you're, you know, pushing really hard on a wrench and it comes loose, you don't want to, or if you push really hard on the wrench and it comes loose, if your hand bashes into something, it'll help to protect your hand and help you to keep from getting a knuckle buster. The next thing are your earplugs. Now for this job, I don't think we're going to need any earplugs, but if you're going to do anything loud, like drilling or hammering or using an air tool like an impact wrench, you always want to make sure you wear your earplugs so that when you're a geezer one day, when you're an old geezer, you don't want to be going around not being able to hear people. So now the last thing that I like to do is to make sure I always wear a hat to protect myself from the sun, and to wear some sunscreen. Like this. This is what I recommend. It's a Bullfrog Mosquito Coast, and it's a combination of sunscreen and insect repellent. So it'll not only to It'll not only help to keep you from getting a sunburn, but it'll also help to keep the mosquitoes away and a lot of other bugs too. So don't forget your safety gear. Now, when you're working on a vehicle, especially when you're working underneath a vehicle, the best piece of equipment to have is a lift, which you can use to raise the vehicle above your head, and you can just stand underneath the vehicle while you're working on it. But most people don't have access to a lift, and so the next best thing is something like I have in front of my truck, which are ramps. These are metal ramps, and I'm going to drive the front wheels up onto the ramps so that I'll have a little bit more room underneath to work. You can also use jack stands as well. You could jack up the vehicle and then lower it down onto jack stands, and then that'll help to give you a little more clearance as well. So again, the best thing to have is a lift, but if you don't have access to a lift, you can use ramps like the ones I have here, or you can use jack stands. Now, also notice that I have plywood underneath my ramps so that when I drive my truck up onto the ramps, they won't sink down into the dirt. Now also notice, in addition to the sheets of plywood that I have underneath my ramps, I have the ramps already positioned so they're right up next to the tires. The wheels are straight and the ramps are straight as well. So if we look here, we can see straight down the ramp to the wheel, and I've got the edge right up against the wheel. And the same thing over here. And I've got it straight with the edge of the vehicle, so that all I have to do is drive up onto it and just make sure I don't go over the edge. Since I'm going to be driving forward onto the ramp, what I'm going to do to make it a little easier is, instead of just putting my truck in drive like that, let me zoom in here, I'm going to put the truck in number one low forward. Alright, and that will give it the most torque going forward. Doesn't give you a lot of speed, but you don't need speed when you're going up a ramp. You just want a lot of torque. So hopefully this will help me to keep me from spinning my wheels, and also it'll give me a little more control when I'm going up the ramp. So again, what I like to do is, when I'm going forwards up a ramp, I like to put it in number one low going forwards. Okay, so let's see if I can get the truck up on the ramps without going over the edge. And hopefully having it in forwards low in the number one position, that will give me some more control. Okay, if you notice, my first attempt didn't work so well. The ramp started to actually slide forwards on the plywood. So I've repositioned everything a little bit. What I've done was make it so that the back ends of the ramp, where the wheels go up, are directly on the ground, so that hopefully they'll bite into the ground a little bit and not slide forwards. Now the front ends of the ramps, they're still on the plywood, and also the sheet of plywood that was sliding the most, the one on the driver's side, I flipped it over so that hopefully the little board that's on the bottom will help to bite into the ground a little bit more. So let's see if I can get it up on the ramps this time without going over. Okay, so I was able to get it up on the ramps, get the truck up on the ramps. It slid a little bit, but it was much better than before. And the front ends are on the plywood so that they're not sinking down into the ground. The back end's sinking down a little bit, but that's not too big of a deal, because the back end has a kind of a broader surface area, because it's more it's at a shallower angle than the front of the ramps, which basically go almost straight down and would really dig into the dirt. So if you ever have trouble with your ramps sliding forwards, put the back ends directly on the ground and just put the front ends of the ramps on plywood. Now, to be absolutely certain that the truck doesn't roll and end up on top of me when I'm working on it, I've put the automatic transmission in park. As you can see, the line under the P indicates that it's in park. Now, if you had a manual transmission, you could just put it in first gear. And then also, what I'll do is I'll set the emergency brake, which you can do by stepping on this pedal here. So let's go ahead and set the emergency brake. Alright, so the emergency brake is set. Now, the next thing I usually do is I will put chocks under the rear wheels. So the rear wheels are going to be held in place because the emergency brake is on, but I'll also put chocks under the wheels as well. Okay, so in addition to having the emergency brake or parking brake set and having the automatic transmission in park to prevent the truck from rolling and landing on top of me, I also have some chocks that I carry with me that I placed under the rear wheels. This one here is under the front of the rear wheel on the passenger side, and it's just a brick. And here's another brick that I carry with me, and it's under the rear of the rear wheel on the passenger side. And then over here, I have a little metal fold-up chalk that I carry with me as well, and that's under the rear of the passenger, or excuse me, of the driver's side rear wheel. So with those chocks and the emergency brake or parking brake set and the automatic transmission in park, I'm pretty certain that my truck's not going to roll and land on top of me. But never cut corners and always remember safety first. Now, to make your job easier when you have to work on bare ground, what I like to do is take some old sheets of plywood and stick them down on the ground, and then also I have an old moving blanket in my garage, and so I usually stick that down as well, and that helps me to be more comfortable. I can focus on my work more, and I don't have to worry about insects crawling on me as much, and I don't have to worry about getting poked by things like sand spurs. So some plywood, something like a moving blanket, or even sheets of old cardboard, I've used those as well in the past, and they work well, and all of that will help you to be more comfortable and to be able to focus on your work better. Now, to open the hood of a 2003 Chevy Avalanche and a lot of other vehicles, you want to first pull on the lever for the hood, and if you look closely, you can see a little icon of a car with a hood open, and so we'll pull on that lever. And you'll hear the click of the latch releasing. And now we'll go up front to open the hood the rest of the way. Now, as you can see, the hood is partially open, but I can't open it just by lifting it. What I have to do is I have to move this little latch to the right and then push up on the hood. And then that will raise it. And there are springs on the sides which will hold it up. Now, some vehicles, they don't have springs. Some of them will have little gas struts, and others won't have that either, and they'll just have a little rod that you have to raise and put into one of the holes on the hood to hold it up. So here's the engine compartment, and we'll start getting to work so that we can change the belts. Now, to release the main drive belt, what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to get access to the belt tensioner, which is down in here, which may be a little difficult to see. Let's see if I can focus in on that. And there's the tensioner right there. There you can see part of it. But I'm going to have to get a little bit better access to it. And I've done a little research and poking around on my truck, and so what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to first clean everything off because I want to keep from getting any dust into the intake, but I'm going to disconnect the connector for the mass airflow sensor here. I'm going to undo this hose clamp right here so that I can disconnect it from the box for the air cleaner. Next, I'm going to undo the bolt here so that I can take this cover off, and what that'll allow me to do is that will allow me to access the bolt for the hose clamp, which holds the intake onto the throttle body. So I'll remove all of that stuff, and hopefully that'll give me enough access to get to the belt tensioner of the main belt so that I can release it and replace it. Now, before I start disconnecting anything on my engine, another safety tip I want to mention is to make sure that, and under most circumstances, you want to make sure that your engine and your exhaust system has had a chance to completely cool before you begin work to reduce the chance of you getting burns. Just make sure everything has had a chance to cool down. What I like to do is I'll let my truck cool down overnight, and then I'll drive it around to the back of my house, and just that little bit of driving isn't enough to heat it up enough to make it hot. But just to be sure, I'll pop the hood and let any other heat escape. And while I'm doing my preparations, it's usually had enough time to cool down completely. So you want to do that anytime you're going to be working on any of the hot engine parts or any engine parts that could be hot. Also, when you're doing an oil change as well, because you don't want to be taking out the drain plug for your oil pan and having hot oil drain onto your hands. So again, make sure the engine has had a chance to cool down completely before you begin work. Now, another thing I wanted to show you is something that I learned about when I was reading through the Haynes service manual that I have for my truck. Let's get in a little bit closer here. And what I'm looking at is the tensioner for the main belt. And here's the tensioner. It's spring loaded. And I've highlighted these marks here with black permanent marker. Okay, we have three marks here on the fixed portion of the tensioner, and then we have a fourth mark here on the movable part of the tensioner, and you can see the belt and the pulley for the tensioner. And according to the Haynes service manual, this mark, which is on the movable part of the belt tensioner, needs to be in between the outermost marks on the fixed portion of the belt tensioner. So this mark here needs to be in between this mark and this mark. If it's outside that region, then your belt is either too small or too large or too loose. So again, make sure that this mark on the movable portion of the tensioner is in between these outer marks on the fixed portion of the belt tensioner. Now, to disconnect the wiring harness from the mass airflow sensor, what I first have to do is take out this gray locking mechanism right here, and that actually helps to prevent the connector of the wiring harness from coming loose itself. So I'm going to pull this gray piece out, which holds the tab in place for the connector of the wiring harness. I'm going to pull that gray piece out, and it comes out completely, and then I will disconnect the connector itself right here. So let's see if I can do that. All right, I'll take my fingernail and I'll put it down in the tab, which is holding the gray piece in place, and let's see if I can get that loose. Okay, so I'll pull this up and out, all right, and then I will press down on the black locking tab of the connector, and that'll push up the other end, and then I can pull it off the mass airflow sensor.
Now, before I disconnect the air intake from the box which houses the air filter, I wanted to show you my Metrinch tool set. Let me zoom out here. There's the logo on the case. Alright, so here's the tool set with a few extra tools that I've kind of mixed in there with it. And what's different about a Metrinch tool set, I don't even know if they still make them or not. I bought these many years ago, but what's different about these tools versus other tools is that they can work with both standard and metric sizes, and that's because of this lobed profile that they have. Instead of having a typical 12-point or 6-point profile, they have this lobed profile here, and that allows them to work with both standard and metric sizes of bolts and nuts. And another advantage that they have is that if the corners have been rounded off, the bolt or the nut, these lobes right here, they actually touch the bolt or the nut near the middle of the face. So even if it's partially rounded off, these wrenches can still turn those bolts or nuts which have been rounded off. So again, this is a Metrinch tool set, and this is one of the combination wrenches from the tool set that I have. And to disconnect or to loosen the hose clamp that's holding the air intake on the box where the air filter is housed, I'm going to use what's called a nut driver. And this is just a little handle right here. It has a square head, alright, and that goes into the socket that I'm going to be using. So again, note the square hole, and this one right here, let's take a look. This works with, let me get it back in the camera. This works with 5/16 and 8mm. So that's what I'm going to be using to loosen the hose clamp on the air intake, which connects to the housing of the air filter. And so again, I'll just take this socket, put it on the end of the nut driver, and that's what I'll use to loosen the hose clamp. Okay, so let's use the 5/16 inch and 8mm socket from my Metrinch set to loosen this hose clamp which holds the air intake to the box for the air filter. And remember, what you want to do is you want to turn it counterclockwise. So always remember, lefty loosey, righty tighty. And that's true for most fasteners and bolts on all sorts of different machinery. So let's turn it counterclockwise. Set that to the side, zoom out a little here, and let's see if we can disconnect that from the box for the air filter. Okay, so there we go, we've got that disconnected. Alright, and then next, what I'll do is move on to this nut here that holds the cover on. Okay, now I've never taken this cover off, but hopefully all I'll need to do is remove the bolt which is right here. And again, that 5/16 inch and 8mm socket from my Metrinch set, that's the one that fits this best. So let's turn it counterclockwise. Again, remember, lefty loosey, righty tighty. And we'll take this one out and see if we can remove this cover. Okay, so I'll turn it counterclockwise. Oh, that's on there pretty tight. Let's see here.
Okay, so there we go. We've got that cover off now, and I can get access to the hose clamp right here to take the air intake off of the throttle body.
Okay, to reduce the chance of getting any dirt and debris in the air intake of my engine and then later having it sucked into my engine, what I'm going to do is I'm going to clean off the throttle body and the air intake components with compressed air. I've also temporarily reconnected the air intake to the box which holds the air filter to prevent from getting any dirt and debris in there also. Now, if you don't have compressed air, another thing you can do is just take a rag, preferably like a moist rag, to hold the dust better, to wipe off any dust and debris from the components. And you can also use a leaf blower if you have one, to blow everything off and to get rid of any dirt and debris. Alright, but before you do any of that, remember safety first and make sure that you have your earplugs in your ears if you're going to use the compressed air or the leaf blower. Okay, so let's clean everything off. Okay, I think that should be good, and now we can take the air intake off the box which holds the air filter again, and we can disconnect it from the throttle body. Okay, now I'm ready to disconnect the air intake from the throttle body, and let's see if I can get this to focus here. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to use the 5/16 and 8mm socket again from my Metrinch tool set, and if you don't have one of these, you can also use a flathead screwdriver to loosen the hose clamp of the air intake. So let's go ahead and take that off the throttle body right now.
We're going to turn it counterclockwise or lefty loosey. Get over here.
Okay, so now the air intake is free of the throttle body. Now, two other things I wanted to make note of on the air intake assembly is first this honeycomb like screen that's on the intake. Now, this isn't the air filter, but it may have some filtering effect. I'm not sure of the exact purpose of it, but I imagine it helps to filter a little bit and then probably also to kind of channel the flow. But my guess is that this is probably pretty fragile, so you want to make sure that you don't dent or ding it when you're moving around the air intake. So what I'm going to do temporarily is put this back on the box again for the air filter. And the reason why I want to put it back on is so that I can work on this portion here. And I've got to take this little mounting arm off of this little tab right here. And I'm not quite sure how I'm going to do that yet. I'll have to work at it to try to get that off. Okay, what I think I'm going to try to do to get this post or tab out of this mounting arm right here is to compress the post with my adjustable wrench here. I'll try to put this on the post right here and compress it, all right? And then also use my flathead screwdriver to pry the two pieces apart. So I'll try to use these pliers right here, these adjustable pliers, and the flathead screwdriver to pry them apart. All right, so let's give that a try and see if we can separate these two pieces. Okay, so there we go. I was able to get them apart. I'm not sure if you're able to see it very well, but using the pliers and the flathead screwdriver, I was able to get those two pieces apart. Okay, so let's take a close-up look so you can see what they look like once they've been separated. Again, here's the little mounting arm, and here's the post or tab that the mounting arm was connected to. And now I should be able to take the whole air intake assembly off the vehicle. And also, since everything was getting kind of hot out here in the sun, I added this rag to keep from burning my arms up here. So make sure you have plenty of rags available, and you can put them down on the vehicle parts that start to get hot just because of the sun. All right, so let's see if I can completely remove the air intake assembly from the engine compartment. Okay, so there we go. I've got it completely loose. I believe this is a resonator chamber right here for the air intake. This is the portion which attaches to the throttle body. And I believe this is another resonance chamber right here. And then here is the end that connects to the box which holds the air filter. And then here's the screen, and I think, after thinking about it, I think what this screen is probably used for is to just make a straight airflow for the mass airflow sensor, which is on the other side of the screen. So I'll have to look that up, but I have a feeling it's just to make sure that the airflow is nice and straight and as turbulence-free as possible, so that the mass airflow sensor can get an accurate reading. Okay, now that we've removed the air intake assembly, you can see the throttle body here, and you can see the valve for the throttle body. And the way it works is that as you step on the gas pedal, the more and more you depress the gas pedal, the more and more this valve will open up and allow more air to flow into the engine. And then when you let off the gas pedal, it will close. So that's basically how you control the speed of your vehicle, by opening and closing that valve to allow more or less air to flow into the engine and increase its speed or decrease its speed. So now, let's look at the main thing that we wanted to get access to, which is the tensioner for the main belt. So here's the tensioner, and what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to try to use a wrench and connect to this hex head right here and turn it with the wrench, and this will allow the arm to swing and loosen the tension on this belt so that I can release the belt. So let's see if we can find the right tool to get in there and something that's long enough to give me enough leverage to do that, because these tensioners are usually very, very tight. And the belts are usually not easy to remove unless you have enough leverage. Okay, before I take the old belts off, another thing that I'm gonna do
is take the new belt out of their packaging and let them kind of unfold and warm up in the sun. And I think that may make it a little easier to put them on if they're if they've straightened out a bit. So again, here's the smaller belt, the one that's used for the air conditioning compressor. And let's take out the larger belt. Put these packages to the side. And here's the larger belt. I'll kind of unfold that and let it stretch out in the sun as well. And I'm hoping that letting it get a little hot will make it easier to route it around the pulleys. All right, so let's let that stretch out in the sun. And we'll just let those heat up there until after I get the old belts off. Now, another thing you want to do before you take the old belts off is to look in the engine compartment and make a note of how they're routed around the pulleys. You can see that it's routed around the tensioner here, routed around the pulley of the crankshaft down there, and then also up a little bit higher. It's a little difficult to see, but it's routed around the pulley of the water pump, I believe. And then, if we come over here, we can easily see that it's routed around the pulley of the alternator, and also it's routed around the pulley for the power steering pump. Now, if you're ever unsure exactly how it's supposed to be routed, in your engine compartment, there should be a diagram of how it's routed. And I believe the one for my engine is right here. It's a little worn out, but this is, I believe, the one that is used for my engine right here. I believe this right here is the tensioner, then down here is the pulley for the crankshaft. This may be for the water pump. Actually, no, I think that's for the camshaft, most likely. And then this is actually maybe for the water pump as well. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what this one is for, but again, this is for the alternator, and this one is for the power steering pump. So this one and this one, I'll have to figure out what those particular ones are for. But again, this is the diagram that indicates how the belt is routed around the pulleys for a V8 engine of a 2003 Chevy Avalanche. And then these are other configurations. This is for a diesel engine, and this one I believe is for a V6 engine, but it's difficult to see it on here. And the Haynes service manuals have these routing diagrams in them as well. Okay, to move the arm of the tensioner, which is down there, and release the belt, I'm going to try to use my 15 millimeter and 19/32 inch combination Metrinch wrench right here that I have. So I'm going to try to use the box end right here, and I'll put it around the nut that's down there, or the hex head down there of the tensioner, and try to move the tensioner so that I can loosen it up enough to get the belt off of the pulley of the tensioner. And then once I have that loose, I can take the belt off of the rest of the pulleys. Okay, so there we go. I was able to
get the tensioner loose enough to get the belt off of it, but I think when I put the new belt on, I'm going to have something with a little bit more leverage. So now let's take the main belt off the rest of the pulleys. All right, it's probably going to be difficult for you to see much of this, but I'm going to take the rest of the main belt off of the pulley for the alternator, and I think there's also a little idler pulley, which is right next to it, and then off of the pulley for the power steering pump and the water pump as well. And I'm going to have to route those around the fan blade as well, which cools the engine. Alright, I've got it off the pulleys, so now what I'm going to do is try to take it out from around the fan blades. Okay, so there we go. I've got the whole main belt off, and we'll take a closer look at it later, but this is it. And taking it off is probably going to be a lot easier than putting the new one back on. And again, here's the pulley for the alternator, and the one for the power steering is down here. And then I believe this one, if you can see it, is an idler, and we'll take a closer look at those. Okay, now that we have the main belt off, let's take a closer look at the pulleys for everything. If you see, this is the pulley for the alternator, and a lot of these pulleys have these ribs on them right here, and those fit into grooves on the belt, and that helps to prevent the belt from sliding off. So again, this is the pulley for the alternator. The one down here is the pulley for the power steering pump, and it also has ribs on it which go into the grooves on the belt. Alright, this pulley right here, let's see here, right here, after taking a closer look at it, I've realized that this is just an idler, which this is an idler pulley, I believe, is the term for it, and I believe the function of this is to allow the belt to be wrapped more completely around some of the pulleys, like this one here, to give the belt a better grip on the pulley. Alright, because if it went straight to the next pulley, it may not have enough surface area to get a really good grip. Alright, so, and notice on this one, this doesn't have any ribs on it because this goes, this touches the outer side of the belt, which doesn't have any grooves on it. And then the belt, or the pulley, which is down here, that's for the water pump. And then there's another pulley, which is farther down, and I don't think I'll be able to, let's see if I can get my little pointer down there. That pulley down there is the pulley for the crankshaft. So right there, that's the one for the crankshaft, and that has ribs on it. Again, this is the idler pulley, and
this is the pulley for the water pump, I believe. And then over here, let's see, this again is the pulley for the tensioner, which keeps tension on the belt. It keeps the belt tight. And it also has ribs on it that go into the grooves of the belt. And I think what I will probably do when I try to put the new belt back on is to route the belt around everything except for the idler here. And then what I'll do is turn the idler, or turn the tensioner arm, and then slip the, hopefully be able to slip the belt over this pulley for the idler, and then release the tensioner arm. And I mean, that's what I'm hoping to do to get the new belt back on. But I haven't done it for this particular vehicle, but other vehicles that I've done it for, it's usually pretty tricky and usually a real big pain in the rear. So let's go ahead and take a closer look at the old belt. Okay, so let's compare the old belt, the old main belt, to the new replacement belts. Now, the first thing you'll notice is the strands of one of the ropes that reinforces the belt. Now, it's normal to see it on the side of an old belt and a new belt, okay? But as the belt gets worn, you'll also start to see signs of those reinforcing fibers, or those reinforcing ropes, running along the length of the outside of the belt. And when you start to see that, that's a good indication that the belt needs to be replaced. And also you'll see that it's kind of shiny and glazed. And then another thing you want to look at are the ribs of the belt. Now, when you get too many cracks in a certain length and a certain unit of length, you want to replace the belt. And also, if there are any chunks out of the belt, you want to replace it. So you want to look for cracking in those ribs, and also look for any chunks taken out of those. And if you see too many cracks along a particular unit of length, I'm not sure exactly how long that unit of length is that they recommend, you want to replace the belt as well, and if you have any chunks taken out as well. I don't see any chunks removed from this belt, but there's definitely a lot of cracking along the length. And again, glazing and signs that the fibers are starting to show through. Now let's take a look at the new main belt. Now the new main belt isn't an exact match. The length is correct, and you'll see it's a little shiny on the back, but I don't think it would be considered as being glazed, and you can't see lines for the reinforcing fibers that are in the belt. You can see the fibers on the side right here, but you can't see them showing through on the back side. And then on the inside of the belt, now this is a Gatorback belt, they have grooves purposely cut across the main grooves that run the length of the belt, and I believe that's probably just to quiet the belt. So cracking probably wouldn't be too much of an issue with this belt as it gets older. It may be, but that may not be a good indicator with this belt, but you would want to look for signs that the fibers are starting to show through. Okay, so again, this is a new Gatorback replacement belt that I'm going to put as a replacement for the main belt. And then lastly, this is, well, that's not a good sign. This is actually my replacement belt, but this looks like this has some wear showing through here, so that's not good. I know this is a brand new belt, but it may just not be a very good quality belt. So I didn't notice that at first, or else I would have returned it. So since I don't really have much time to finish this repair and Napa's closed today, I think I'm going to have to go ahead and use this belt, and hopefully it'll last for a while. And if this one breaks, it's not that big of a deal, because it just drives the air conditioning compressor, and I'll just lose my air conditioning. But the other ones are critical, because the main
belt, the most important thing that it drives is the water pump. And if you lose your water pump, your engine will overheat. It also drives the alternator and the power steering, so those are fairly important as well. So let's go ahead and we'll take the smaller belt off for the air conditioning compressor. Okay, another thing that I forgot to mention when comparing the old and new belts is to make sure you count the number of grooves on each of the belts to make sure they're the same. So let's count the number of grooves on the old belt. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 grooves on the old belt, and here is the new belt, and let's see, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 grooves on the new belt. So both the old and the new belt have 5 grooves, and we'll do the same check for the smaller belt for the air conditioning compressor. Okay, to release the tensioner for the small belt and release the belt that drives the AC compressor, the air conditioning compressor, I'm going to use a small 3/8 inch drive extension, which is attached to my 3/8 inch drive ratchet. All right, and that's in the square hole of the tensioner right now, and I'm going to turn that wrench, or turn that ratchet, and that will release the tension on the belt, and I can remove it from the pulley of the tensioner, and then I can remove it from the crankshaft pulley and the pulley for the AC compressor. And I'll show you in just a sec why the ratchet is called a 3/8 inch drive. Okay, on most rulers which measure inches, they typically have 1/8 inch divisions. And on this little ruler that I have, the standard ruler that I have on my Swiss Army knife, it also has 1/8 inch divisions. So we'll go from 1 to 2 inches, and we'll count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and there's the 2 inch mark. So those are 1/8 inch divisions. Okay, and the reason why a 3/8 inch ratchet, or a 3/8 inch drive ratchet, is called a 3/8 inch drive ratchet is because of the fact that it's 3/8 inch across. So let's measure that. We'll start from the 1 inch mark. We'll go 1/8, 2/8, 3/8. Okay, so that's a typical drive size. Now, there are also, I believe, 1/4 inch drives and 1/2 inch drives, and then larger drives as well for heavier duty stuff. But this is a 3/8 inch drive ratchet. And then the extension that I'm going to use for it is a 3/8 inch drive extension, and it's about 3 inches long. Okay, so that's the extension that I'm going to use to turn the tensioner for the air conditioning compressor belt. Okay, I'm going to try to make it so that you can get somewhat of a view of me releasing this tensioner pulley and pulling off the smaller belt which drives the air conditioning compressor. Okay, I'm slipping the belt off the tensioner. Alright, got that off there. The tensioner is completely released. Now I'm going to have to probably slide it off. Let's see here. It's going to be tricky. Take it off the AC compressor first, and now I've got it off the pulley for the crankshaft, and there we go. There is the smaller belt that I just took off. So hopefully you could see a little bit of that. And we'll take a closer look at it and compare it to the new replacement belt.
Okay, let's compare the old belt for the AC compressor, the air conditioning compressor, which is on the left here. This is the old belt, to the new replacement belt, which is on the right. The first thing you can see is that we've definitely got some signs that the strands are starting to show through. Here's a crack in the outer portion of the belt, and then here's a real obvious sign of a problem, is that one of the strands has actually broken. Now, this may have broken when I was taking it off, but regardless, it's still pretty worn out. There's cracks on the outside of the belt. It's kind of shiny and glazed, and also a lot of cracks on the inside of the belt. Okay, so this is the old belt that drives the air conditioning compressor. Here's the replacement belt. Now, this one, I think, again, is of questionable quality from Napa because of the fact that you can kind of see the strands, and there was an obvious area on here. Let's see if I can find it again, where the strands were really showing through, about right here. So that, I don't really like the quality of this belt, but Napa's closed, and I need to be able to drive my truck tomorrow, and I won't be able to do the repair tomorrow. Today's a Sunday and it's closed, and won't be able to do it tomorrow. I need to be able to drive the truck. So I'm just gonna go ahead and use this belt. And again, if this belt breaks, it's not that big of a deal, because the air conditioning will go out. So, and again, this one is the replacement, and you don't see any cracks along the length of it. And then let's also compare the number of grooves. We've got 1, 2, 3 grooves here. We have 1, 2, 3 grooves on the replacement. Okay, so I think they're a good match.
Okay, so now I'm gonna try to put the replacement belt back on for the air conditioning compressor. And hopefully this one will be fairly easy. I think this is gonna be the easiest one compared to the main belt. I think that's gonna be real tricky. So let's get started, and hopefully you'll be able to see at least a little bit of the stuff that I have to do. Okay, so I've got the ribs here, and it's got to go on this inner portion of the pulley for the crankshaft. Try to route it around, get it seated on the pulley for the crankshaft so I can relieve as much tension as possible, and then put it around the pulley for the AC compressor and make sure that it's fully seated on there. And then what I'll do is I'll get my wrench and try to adjust the tensioner here. And this, actually, what I may have to do is take it off the AC compressor and wrap it around the tensioner first, I think. And again, I've never done this particular build for this vehicle before, so it's a little tricky. All right, so it's around the pulley for the crankshaft and around the top of the tensioner. So let's put the ratchet in there. Can find the hole there. Okay, there we go. Got it in the hole. All right, now I'm gonna pull down on the tensioner. Actually, I want to push up a little bit on my ratchet to give me a little start here and have some room to pull it down. All right, I'm pulling down on the tensioner. Now I'm gonna try to route it around the pulley for the air conditioning compressor and keep it on the tensioner and the crankshaft pulley at the same time. So this will be a little tricky, I think. Okay, I think it's getting started. Let's get that seated a little bit better on there so we have a little more slack. Oh shoot, let's see. That came off, that's not good. Okay. Maybe I'll do this side first on the AC compressor and then worry about routing it around here. If I can get enough slack. Let's see. I may have to release it a little bit and pull it down just a little bit more to try to get a little more slack from that tensioner. Okay, I think I'm gonna have to release it again from the AC compressor. Try to take it off there. Try to get it around the pulley for the crankshaft again. Hold that there, I think. Get it around the pulley for the tensioner, and let's see, okay, if I can get it around the pulley for the AC compressor, and I think that just might be it. Okay, if everything feels like it's seated, I think. Yep. Okay, now I'm gonna release the tensioner, and let's just check it out and see if everything looks like it's in place, and I'll bring you up for a closer look. That was a little tricky, but not too bad. Let's take a close look. Make sure everything's properly routed around the pulleys. So you can see that it's routed around the tensioner pulley. It's seated, fully seated in the pulley for the crankshaft. And it's also seated in the pulley for the AC compressor. So I think that one's good. And we've got the replacement in place, and I think that'll do it for that one. Now the next one is gonna be the trickiest one. That'll be the main belt. So let's zoom out so we can take one more look. Okay, there we go. Okay, so let's also check out the AC compressor belt from up top and make sure that it looks like it's properly seated. And there it is on the pulley for the AC compressor, and it looks like it's well seated to me. It looks like it's in place. Let's see if we can get another look over here. Maybe we can see if maybe we can take a look at the idler. It may be a little too dark down there. Yeah, I don't think we're gonna be able to get the camera to give us a good look, but there's where it is on the idler right there. And then it's also wrapped around the pulley for the crankshaft. And let's see if we can get a better look at that from the other side.
Okay, here's a view of the air conditioning compressor wrapped around the pulley for the crankshaft from up top. And from up here, it also looks like it's well seated on the pulley. So I think that particular belt is good to go. And here is one more shot that I didn't show you before, but you can see the belt on the crankshaft pulley running by the tensioner. See if we can zoom in there. There it is on the tensioner pulley. And then over to the pulley for the air conditioning compressor. And again, it looks well seated and in the proper position for the belt. Okay? Let's get on to the next one. Okay, the next thing I have to do is put the main belt on, and this is going to be the trickiest part. But after looking at the routing diagram, it looks like I don't need to route it around the, I don't think I need to bring it around the fan blade because of the way it's routed. So let's see if I can get it in there, and hopefully you'll be able to see at least some of the stuff that I'm doing. Okay, the bare end of the belt, the outside of the belt, is going to go down around the water pump pulley, and around the crankshaft pulley. So let's see if we can get it routed around that crankshaft pulley and seat it in place. Okay, so I've got it in place around the crankshaft pulley. I'm going to bring it up, and I think the next thing will be to route it around the power steering pulley. The power steering pulley. Let's get it back around the flat side, or the get the outside around the pulley for the water pump. Let's get it seated around the pulley for the power steering. Seated on the pulley for the here's the pulley for the alternator. I'm gonna leave it off the idler. Okay. And pull some tension. And I'll try to get it to go around the pulley for the tensioner. Alright, and then this, pull this down over the tensioner. Let's see. Well, that may not be quite right. Let's see what we got here. It's got to go the other way around the crankshaft, actually. So I got that a little wrong here, but I think I can reposition it easily. Had a little too much slack there. I'm going to take it off the tensioner pulley, route it a different way around the crankshaft.
Okay.
Oops, let's take it back up here. It's a little tricky, as you can see. So I'm trying to get it around the crankshaft pulley again because I had it positioned incorrectly there at first. Alright. Now let's see if we can get this spaghetti to go into place, right? There. Going around the water pump pulley. Around the pulley for the power steering pump. Okay, I've got it on, seated on the pulley for the power steering pump. Seating it on the pulley for the alternator. Double checking to make sure it's seated properly on the crankshaft pulley. Then I'm going to pull it around. Okay, I've got it on the tensioner pulley. Let's double check to make sure everything's positioned right and seated. Okay. Alright, so. Looks like it's seated properly around the pulley for the crankshaft, the pulley for the power steering pump, the pulley for the alternator, and the pulley for the tensioner. And now what I'm going to try to do is relieve enough tension on the tensioner with my wrench, see if I can get enough leverage to slip it over this idler pulley. Okay. All right, so I think we got it, and that didn't take near as much leverage as I thought it would. And I think that's, let's double check everything. Make sure it's all routed properly. Okay, and I think that looks good.
Now, before we put everything else back on and start the engine up, I want to double check to make sure everything looks like it's routed properly and make sure that the belts look like they're seated properly on each pulley. So here's the pulley for the alternator. Let's look around it. Okay, there's the pulley for the power steering pump, and it looks like it's seated well. Looks like the ribs are going into the grooves like they're supposed to. Let's look on the other side of that pulley. See if we can get a view down in there. Okay, so I think everything is lined up on that pulley properly, on the power steering pump pulley. Alright, because you don't want it to be off of it, because it could jump the pulley and that would tear up the belt and make a big mess. So here it is coming around the water pump pulley. And you can kind of see just a little bit there of it. Then
it goes around the crankshaft pulley. Let's zoom in a little bit there, see if we can get it to focus. It's not wanting to focus quite, right? But let's zoom out a little bit and see if we can get a better view. But okay, so there we go. Now let's see if we can get it to hold that focus. So there, the ribs are in the grooves. It looks like that's seated properly, and we'll check it from below as well just to be certain. And then here is the pulley for the tensioner, and we'll look at it from the top. So it looks like it's aligned properly and properly seated in the pulley. Now if you notice, the mark here on the movable part of the tensioner is a little bit outside this mark on the fixed part of the tensioner, but I'm guessing it will probably move inward just a bit as the belt stretches, because this is a brand new belt, so I'm hoping it'll stretch and move inward in between the two outer marks where it's supposed to be. So it's supposed to be in between this mark and this mark over here, and that's this mark that I'm talking about. So this one, this mark here on the movable part of the tensioner, should be in between this mark and this mark of the fixed portion of the tensioner. So I'm hoping as the belt is used and it stretches a little bit, it will move in between those two. Okay, so let's take a quick look underneath, and you can see that it looks like the main belt is properly seated on the pulley of the crankshaft. Let's get a look over here. And I think that looks good. And you can see underneath that it also looks properly seated on the pulley for the power steering pump. And there it is again on the crankshaft. It's this outer belt here that we just put on. And again, this is for the AC compressor, the air conditioning compressor. And I think that looks good. So I think we're safe to go ahead and start up the truck after we put the air intake back on. Okay, so we've got the belts back on and we've checked to make sure that they're positioned properly on the pulleys. Now the next thing we have to do is put the air intake back in place. Alright, so I'm going to route it down underneath this coolant line. And again, I want to be careful not to damage the screen on the end of the air intake that connects to the box which holds the air filter. So I'm going to put that on first. Okay, next I'll put the end on that goes over the throttle body. All right, then I'll tighten the hose clamp with my nut driver. And remember, righty-tighty, so we're gonna turn it clockwise. Make sure it's fully seated. Tighten it down. Okay, that feels like it's pretty secure. Now let me bring you over to the other one. Okay, now I'm looking at the end of the intake that connects to the box which holds the air filter. I want to make sure that it's fully connected on there. Let's press it on there all the way.
Okay, and I think that's as far as it's going to go. We'll tighten down the hose clamp, and again, righty-tighty, so we're going to turn it clockwise. And I don't think there's a particular torque setting for these. You just have to hand tighten them. And don't go too crazy, but just use your best judgment. And let's make sure that that feels secure. Yep, I think that's good. And then let's find the wiring harness for the to reconnect back to the mass airflow sensor. Here that is. We'll get a closer look at what that looks like. Again, we're going to have to take this gray portion out so that we can push down on the black tab and allow the connector to go over this little triangular portion right here and lock in place. Actually, before I reconnect the mass airflow sensor, I'm going to connect that bracket to the pin or the tab that I was showing you before. Okay, so there we go. We've got that in place. Let's see if we can get a better shot of it right there. So there it is. That's what I just reconnected. I put this little mounting arm back onto that. And let's see if we can get a little bit better view there. Zoom in there. And that's what the close-up view of it looks like. So we've got that back together. Now let's connect the wiring harness to the mass airflow sensor. Okay, so let's go ahead and reconnect that wiring harness to the mass airflow sensor, and I'll show you what needs to be done again. I'm going to take out this little gray tab, and I'll use my fingernail to release it. Pull up on that. There it is. I'm going to take it out. And then this little tab right here, let's see if you can see it in the camera there. Right there where I'm pointing to, that little black tab right there above the purple connector is going to go down over the triangular tab, which is on the mass airflow sensor. Okay, so you want to hear that lock in place. Actually, let's take that back off again. Another thing you want to do is just double check the condition of the connectors inside there. Make sure they don't look corroded, make sure they look in good condition, and make sure that the seal around the connector looks like it's in good condition, and also check the pins on the mass airflow sensor itself. All right, so the seal looks good. Let's reconnect it. All right, now I'll reinsert the gray piece of the connector, which locks the other tab in place. Okay, snaps in place there. And there we go. Nice and secure on the mass airflow sensor. Okay, so I have everything back together, and one last thing I did before I go ahead and start up the engine to test everything is I double checked. I looked around the engine compartment, I looked around the edge of the engine compartment to make sure that I didn't have any tools or rags or anything down in the pulleys or around the edge of the engine compartment that could fall down into the pulleys and belts and tear everything up. So that's very important. You want to, before you start up the engine again to test everything out, you want to double check on top and around and underneath the engine to make sure that there's nothing that's going to fall down into the engine and get tangled in the belts and the fan blades and pulleys. Okay, so let's go ahead and start it up and see if it either flies apart or if it runs properly.
Okay, so there we go. All the belts look like they're working well, and I think we're back in action. Okay, everyone, the belts look like they were working well. And one last thing I wanted to show you is that, as I suspected, the mark here on the movable portion of the tensioner has moved back within range of between this marker here and this marker here on the fixed portion of the tensioner. And actually, when the engine was running, it was actually a little bit farther in between them, so it was a little bit farther over here when the engine was running. But when I shut it off, it shifted a little bit back over this way. So now the belt has stretched out a little bit, and the indicator, or the mark on the movable portion of the belt tensioner, is back where it's supposed to be, in between this marker and this marker on the fixed portion of the belt tensioner. Okay, and for everyone's reference, it's Sunday, May 3rd, 2015. My vehicle is a 2003 Chevy Avalanche, so it's about 12 years old. The engine has about, the engine has 4,444.3 hours on it, according to the hour meter. And the vehicle has 126,558 miles according to the odometer. Okay, so one more thing which I forgot to do before we tested the engine was to put this cover back on, but I don't think that's a big deal. So we'll go ahead and we'll put that on right now. And again, there's this one nut that holds it in place.
I'll guide it down into those little tabs and also hold it. Okay. Remember, righty tighty. So we're going to turn it clockwise. If I can position down on there. There we go, I think that's it. All right, so I think that's nice and secure in place.
And we'll start it up one more time just to be sure everything's in good working order. Okay, there we go, one more successful test. Okay, everyone, replacing the belts on my 2003 Chevy Avalanche went well. It went much better than I expected, and it wasn't near as hard as I thought it was going to be. On other vehicles that I've done this on, the tensioners are super tight, and you really got to crank on them to get the belts loose, but on the Avalanche, they weren't bad at all, and everything went together well. So, thanks for watching, and I hope you learned something. Take care.